many cases, products that generated here now hanging around with nothing to do is gonna go bind to enzyme number one, because without number one, nothing of this, none of this chain reaction is possible. So it's gonna go to bind to number one enzyme allosterically and stop the entire chain of event. This is called feedback inhibition when product act on the enzyme as an allosteric inhibitor, non-competitive inhibitor, and shut the reaction. So when you're talking about, the question is, what type of inhibition for enzymatic reaction do you know? You have to say competitive inhibitor, and allosteric or non-competitive inhibitor that happened on allosteric site of enzyme in two versions, one of which allosteric inhibitor bind, just like it's shown here, bind to allosteric site and changes configuration of active site. The other side, allosteric inhibition is through the product itself, which called feedback inhibition. And this is example of this feedback inhibition. This is amino acid, as a leucine isomeric form, that bound to enzyme form the end product isoleucine right from threonine. And so threonine is bind to active site as a substrate. And then through the series of five enzymatic reactions, finally we have isoleucine. And isoleucine is a final product. When it's enough, it's no longer needed for cell to use. This is cell using it, enough isoleucine, it's bind to the allosteric site of enzyme, the first enzyme, stop it, that's it, the reaction is done. The first enzyme no longer catalyzes anything. It's feedback inhibition. Enzymes located in different parts of the cell, they could be simply located in cytosol, for glycolysis, for example, for fatty acid synthesis, for protein synthesis, they can be in mitochondria. In mitochondria, citric acid or Krebs cycle and electron transfer chain enzymes, they all located, fatty acid oxidation also located in mitochondria. In the nucleus, a lot of enzymes that account for DNA replication, for transcription, they are in the nucleus, lysosomic enzyme, proteolytic enzymes located in lysosomes. It's in eukaryotic cell. In bacterial and prokaryotic cells, it's more primitive. They're mainly located all around the cytoplasm and some may be in the vesicles of the bacteria. That's it. That's about it. Vesicles or cytoplasm. That's multi-location. And this is mitochondrial enzymes and location. And you know that mitochondria once upon a time used to be a bacterial cell. So they have their own enzymes as well. And more importantly, enzymes that enable Krebs cycle and electron transfer chain. In the matrix of mitochondria, here matrix, it's Krebs cycle enzyme, and embedded as integral proteins in the inner part of the plasma membrane and the CRISPRs, those would be the electron transfer chain enzymes. They also integral proteins. A plasma membrane of the cell can have enzymes such as in bacterial cell or eukaryotic cell, say adenylate cyclase, very commonly embedded in a plasma membrane and account for conversion of adenosine monophosphate into cyclic adenosine monophosphate as a second messenger. It's integral protein of the plasma membrane. As far as in if ATP is a major energy-possessing molecule in the body, we need somehow to produce it, right? To produce, to store it and to use it when cell needs it. So we have requirements for some kind of fuel or supplies, substrates that allow us to produce enough ATP to sustain through environmental changes and adaptation to those changes. It would be kind of not exactly making sense if we will use ATP as a source of energy to produce ATP. It would not do us any good. So some kind of other sources of energy have to be involved in production of ATP that we technically call respiration in order to generate enough ATP to have normal ability to adapt to environmental changes in the open system which we are in our cells are. This energy could come from sunlight in the ecosystem. It's one of the major sources of energy. And this photosynthetic process, utilization of the sunlight energy by the plants on Earth, generate oxygen that we can use in our respiratory reaction to produce ATP, as well as it allows plants to generate organic molecules, specifically carbohydrates, that we can use as a substrate in enzymatic reactions that will allow us to produce ATP. Plants can do this and they use this. We can utilize oxygen that produced by plants, we can utilize carbohydrates, but where we can bring energy from? Energy in our mitochondria, in the cells of our body or eukaryotic cells, can derive from electron flow. So the electron flow, sunlight generate electron flow in the plant cells because they have chloroplast with chlorophylls as their absorbing, light absorbing molecules. In mitochondria, it's not an option. In mitochondria, there is chain of enzymes and electron carriers that sort of move electrons back and forth and generate proton gradient. And this is what creates energy in our cells that we can use to build up ATP. As far as ATP building process, we have different types of those reactions. We have first aerobic respiration. What does it mean? It means that we're using oxygen, yes, but what do we use it for? We use oxygen in aerobic respiration as a final electron acceptor. Why? Because we generate more electrons and protons that we know what to do with. And therefore, in electron transfer chain, we can only use so many protons and meaning so many electrons. We have couple of extras that we cannot leave unattended. If we leave them unattended, they are electrically charged particles. They're very active. They're going to go around and they're going to ruin everything around themselves. Therefore, we need to put them in a good use. And we use energy of those extra electrons to neutralize those extra protons, simply adding hydrogen ions, which is protons, to oxygen, forming water molecules. The rest of the protons and electrons utilized as a source of energy to build up ATP. This is aerobic. Anaerobic respiration, when we don't use oxygen, but cells can use other inorganic molecules, such as nitrate, sulfur, the carbon, they can use it to do the same thing. They can neutralize the extra hydrogen ion, forming methane, ammonia, hydrogen sulfur for the same purpose. And if they have electron transfer chain, they can generate the same high number of ATP as our aerobic cells can do. Those two a type of respiration, and another process is, but no matter what, whether it's aerobic or anaerobic, the glycolysis have to be the first step. And in both cases, the aerobic or anaerobic, we were talking about electron transfer chain, where you, as an outcome, can generate up to 32-34 molecules of ATP. What if cell does not have electron transfer chain? What can happen? Depending on what enzymes cell have, it can convert the products of glycolysis. It's going to have glycolysis regardless. And then it's going to convert the products of glycolysis into either lactic acid or ethanol, alcohol. Therefore, we have lactic fermentation and alcoholic fermentation. Very well. Can this be no electron transfer chain and no enzyme for lactic-alcoholic fermentation? Absolutely. In which case, we will have anaerobic respiration, but without electron transfer chain. Do the same thing, neutralize extra hydrogen ions by using inorganic molecule, creating methane, hydrogen, sulfur, or ammonia. And it's happened all the time. How it came to be there, we will see in a second. So the cellular respiration, taking glucose, adding, say, an aerobic condition, oxygen, and breaking it down to carbon dioxide, water, and energy, ATP. And plants do the same thing, except plants utilize, they work in reverse, they generate ATP using sunlight, and then take water and carbon dioxide from environment, form glucose, and for the most part, they are oxygenic, they release ATP. It can be anoxygenic photosynthesis, but for the most part, they do release oxygen. In order to understand cellular respiration reaction, you need to have understanding of redox reaction. Redox is short for oxidation-reduction reaction. Oxidation-reduction reaction is a special type of chemical reaction where reactions happen due to electron exchange. Not sharing, not stealing, like covalent versus ionic bonds, where it's either shared or stealing. Take an electron. Those are, yes, there is electron donor, electron acceptor, but they don't actually combine with one another. They remain free, and sometimes the same element can be donor and acceptor. And so the oxidized element is the one that losing electron, is a donor. The reduced is the one that accept. In this case, you can see the same iron and silver, or gold rather. One would be oxidized because it's giving electron. The other one is gaining electron. This one is gaining, this one is giving, right? Sort of those would be donor and acceptor. So the oxidation would be losing, reduction would be gaining. And this oxidation reduction reaction, this is what all the respiratory chemical processes are based on. This is sodium chloride in ionic bonds, right? The gain and loss, but it's happened, they would form ionic bond because they are salt. If we go back to this picture, it's redox reaction happening between the same elements, so they're not going to react, they're just going to gain, lose or gain electrical charge, becoming either positively or negatively charged. In case of salt and metal, metal and non-metal, like here, they do the same exchange, gain and lose electron, but then because they different element, the different ions, they're gonna come into ionic bonds. If they, of course, in close proximity from one another, it's the other condition. So there are electron donor and electron acceptor. This is what basically in this giving and taking electrons from one substance to another, it's basically the whole basic of cellular respiration. And the last electron acceptor would be, the final electron acceptor would be the one that neutralizes the extra electrons that have no application, further application in respiratory processes. In case of aerobic, it would be oxygen. And this is just reaction methane and oxygen. So methane exchange the electrons with oxygen, forming carbon dioxide. It's coupled with reduction of energy. This is how it's all happened, and forming water. So the oxygen through the acquiring electrons through hydrogen, addition of hydrogen becoming reduced, and the carbon becoming oxidized because it's adding, losing hydrogen, and with hydrogen it's losing electrons. Now it's becoming oxidized, right? And oxygen is reduced. And this again in cellular respiration. One reduced, the other one oxidized. Why hydrogen we using so often? Because hydrogen has only one proton, only positively charged proton, and therefore it can only give or take one electron, right? Normal, the hydrogen atom. One proton, one electron. So take one electron, it's can easily attach, take one electron and it's gonna have positive charge, which called proton, and it's gonna run around looking for electrons. Once it's find electron, it's gonna attach it. It's exactly why we said that pH is important for enzymatic activity. So the hydrogen ion used as an electron carrier in cellular respiration. It's convenient because it's one only, and if it's many, it would be dangerous. They all charge particles. So one, and it could be easily dissociated and easily connected to the electron. On the other hand, so the hydrogen would be sort of attachment point for the electrons. On the other hand, the electrons, the protons and electrons have to be delivered to the site of cellular respiration, to the enzymes that participate in respiratory processes, and at the same token, those enzymes have to be activated. They have to be become active. So activation of enzyme is a job for coenzymes. Coenzymes are vitamins. So in our cellular respiration, we using vitamins, specifically nicotine adenine dinucleotide, attaching hydrogen, well, not we, our cells. So the NAD act as electron acceptor because it's get hydrogen ion attached to it. Hydrogen ion immediately drives electron towards and becoming reduced. So the NADH electron acceptor is getting reduced, acting as oxidizing agent for the molecule that gives it electron. NADH is reduced stage of NAD. And this is what. So the job for this NAD, which is vitamin S2, to carry hydrogen ion as an electron carrier and to activate enzymes that participate in electron transfer chain, because this is vitamin, this is coenzyme, and this will be will result in synthesis of adenosine triphosphate. This is exactly what happened. This is nicotinamine dinucleotide, right? This is what happened here. This is a whole thing. It's oxidized. It's have positively charged. This is nitrogen that positively charged. Hydrogen comes here. Now it's bind to hydrogen ions. Hydrogen ions immediately attract electrons to neutralize themselves. It's becoming reduced. It's no longer charged, right? And so now, but when it comes to the electron transfer chain, it can utilize the power of those two electrons and two protons in order to invest the energy in ATP synthesis. And so we have this happened, all of this happened in, so now let's talk about this for a second. So glycolysis is gonna go regardless because it's the first stage, necessary stage for the cell to get ATP. But the goal of glycolysis, if cell has electron transfer chain, the goal of glycolysis would not be to build ATP because it's only two molecules of ATP. And when you're looking at the perspective of getting 34, 35, 36 molecules of ATP, two is nothing. It's nice bonus, but it cannot be a goal of the whole glycolysis. The goal of glycolysis create two pyruvic acid, two pyruvates. Why do we need two pyruvates? Because later on this pyruvic acid is gonna enter the Krebs cycle. What is the goal of Krebs cycle? Goal of Krebs cycle would be using those conversions of acetyl coenzyme A that coming from pyruvic acid to generate as many NADH as possible. This is what goal, because NADH are electrons carriers through the hydrogen as well as coenzymes for enzymes that participate in electron transfer chain. If cell does not have electron transfer chain, it still has glycolysis, then none of them is not gonna happen. We'll see what's gonna happen then. So the electron transfer chain sort of like catalyze enzymatic reaction that separate hydrogen ion from electrons using electron energy and hydrogen ion or protons flow to build up ATP. This is the outcome. This is very tightly controlled because every step of this reaction catalyzed by specific enzymes that embedded in mitochondria, inner mitochondrial membrane. So therefore, in stages of cellular respiration, we have three: glycolysis, then acetic acid cycle. That pre-stage would be oxidation of pyruvate and conversion it into acetyl coenzyme A, and then oxidative phosphorylation, which is electron transfer chain. Oxidative phosphorylation because it's in involve oxidative reduction reaction, phosphorylation because it's adding of phosphorus to ADP. Phosphorus and ADP have to be there present. If you deprive cell from phosphorus and ADP, and you can have all oxygen on earth, all glucose on earth, reaction is not going to happen. So this is what happening: glycolysis in eukaryotic cells happening in cytoplasm. But glycolysis end up in having only two molecules of ATP through, what we didn't talk about, substrate level of phosphorylation. I did tell you that it's oxidative phosphorylation because it happens through a reaction of oxidative reduction reaction. Whether in glycolysis, it's simply swap on phosphorus from one component to another, from ATP to glucose, from glucose back to ATP. This is called substrate level phosphorylation. Then we have oxidative phosphorylation. And what plants are doing, utilizing sunlight and generating electron flow through sunlight, it would be photophosphorylation. So technically speaking, we have three levels of phosphorylation. Substrate level, simply swapping phosphorus between chemicals. Oxidative phosphorylation, using oxidative reduction reactions through exchange of electrons back and forth. It's and by doing so, energizing enzymes that adds phosphorus to ADP. And photophosphorylation, that plants using in photosynthesis using sunlight. So glycolysis, which results in substrate level phosphorylation, performed in the cytoplasm of eukaryotic or prokaryotic cells. The Krebs cycle happened in the matrix of mitochondria. The oxidative phosphorylation or electron transfer chain happened in the space between inner and outer membrane of mitochondria. In bacterial cells, the Krebs cycle, both glycolysis and Krebs cycle, happened in the cytoplasm of bacteria, whether electron transfer chain happened between inner membrane, plasma membrane of bacteria and bacterial cell wall. And this is how prokaryotic and eukaryotic cells differ. Again, cellular respiration separated and aerobic was when we use oxygen as a final acceptor of electrons carried by hydrogen, and then anaerobic when you use either inorganic molecules to touch hydrogen, or we convert, if the enzymes are present, we convert pyruvic acid to another organic molecules, which is lactic acid or ethanol. It depends what enzymes cell have. How does it happen and why it's happened, we'll discuss later. So oxidative phosphorylation, the chain of reaction through the enzyme embedded in between inner and outer membrane, in inner membrane of mitochondria or in the plasma membrane of bacteria, where those enzymes get activated by vitamins and NADH, generated a proton gradient and electron flow, and then enzyme activated, enzyme called the ATP synthase. This enzyme work on chemoosmosis. What does it mean? The hydrogen ions enter the enzyme slots in this molecule, and by doing so, make it rotate. And every rotation, mechanical energy adds ATP to phosphorus, which is oxidative phosphorylation. Because right here, we utilize two extra hydrogen ion and two extra electrons to neutralize this, forming water from oxygen. So all air that you breathe in through your lungs, through your respiratory system, we use all oxygen that we breathe in, used at the very last or one before last step of electron transfer chain. This is why you have this whole lung machinery and respiratory system machinery for the very last step of cellular respiration. Enzymes utilized here in coenzymes, just like we talked before. And let's talk about glycolysis. Glycolysis always is there. It's 10-step enzymatic process. By no means I want you to memorize all enzymes. I want you to understand the principle. It's happened with two stages. One stage is energy investment phase. Like anything in life, if you're trying to set up new business, you have to invest money before you can collect any profit. And this is happening the same way. You have to invest ATP, and you do. You invest two ATP molecules. And then you gain four ATP molecules, which gives you net of two ATP molecules. Very low harvesting, therefore if cell has electron transfer chain, I repeat again, the goal of glycolysis is not to make ATP. If cell does not have it, yes, the glycolysis would be the only source of ATP. Let's talk about what happened in glycolysis. So we invest two ATP molecules and convert the glucose into glucose phosphate and then fructose biphosphate. Through the series, because we want to break down this circular hexameric glucose molecule into two linear three carbon, glucose has six carbons. We need to make two three carbon pyruvic acid that we can invest in Krebs cycle. So the goal here would be for glycolysis to convert glucose into pyruvic acid. ATP is a nice bonus, but not a goal. And also another nice bonus, and what coming out of it, would be two NADH molecules. If we have electron transfer chain, it's okay because we can use this. If we don't have, this is a dangerous situation because they are here, they are absolutely obligatory result of glycolysis.